we were all agreed that this is, you know, why is this not being implemented? You know, is it a matter of the intervention that we created was really more complex, more complicated than is reasonable? You know, and it's really not feasible to, you know, can we rethink something that would maybe address it in a similar way but be less cumbersome for the teacher? Or, you know, do you just need to figure out a way to do this?
Sorry, I just want to do a sign check.
It's just after 12. I'm sorry, it's just after 10. We were going to 10:10, but we did start a little late. Can you wrap up in 15?
Because we originally thought we had 75 minutes, and then we're trying to make it run a little bit longer.
We have some time at the end, because Megalina has agreed to wait till next month, so I'd say 15, 20 minutes.
So I'm going to talk about when to request or when to refer families for neuropsych testing. I just want to be clear, though, that we're not talking about neuropsych testing, that lovely list that Lizzie put out. That's what we're, like, the places that we are referring families in the Bronx to go for additional testing, we'll do some aspects of that, but not necessarily going to be like the whole enchilada.
And you don't always need the whole enchilada.
You don't, right. Sometimes it's excessive. But basically, if they've gone through a Board of Ed psychoeducational eval, and sometimes it comes back, well, everything looks fine, right? Cognitive testing is fine, academics are generally within the average range, which, you know, 25th percentile or above, so we're good, we're not going to give the kid any services. But there's, you know, that there's something else going on. They could be, it's just that they're not doing their work, or the parents are concerned, or they're doing like the bare minimum. There could be an attention issue, there could be a language issue, then you would want to go for request extra testing. And then the other one reason would be if the academics are low, but there's not enough, you want more information on what process and what kind of threads are running through, that what process is going awry and where you can intervene. And so the neuropsych testing gives you that extra information. So, like, is it that they need help with planning? Is it their vocabulary? Is it receptive language? Things like that. So basically, if you feel like they're not getting enough services and you don't have enough information, that's when you would seek extra testing.
Or they are getting services and they're not working.
Right, they're getting something, but it's not quite doing what it should be doing. So how do you get this elusive neuropsych eval? Lizzie has had some successful fights with the Board of Ed to get it covered. If you can prove that what the school board already did isn't enough, then they can theoretically pay to have it done. Just like they will theoretically pay for a private school if there's no school within the system that meets the child's needs. This is really, it's tough, and it takes a lot of legwork, and I give you
a lot of time.
Yeah, a lot of credit. I've never gone that far. What the other option is to either pursue testing through private means. And it depends on whether you have public insurance like Medicaid or Medicaid Managed Care or private insurance. There is a lovely list on the iDrive that we're going to email everything out to all of you, that goes through sites that offer low fee sliding scale testing. So a lot of private insurances will not cover neuropsych testing, like if it's just for attention. They say, well, the school should be doing that. And then the school says, well, it's a medical issue. The private practice should be doing that. And you get stuck in that loophole. So parents end up having to pay. Sometimes it's a couple hundred dollars. Sometimes it can be a little more than that. Parnes, we all know Parnes. They do a nice job. The Dean Hope Center, which is part of Teachers College at Columbia University, also has a testing center. And they do testing and tutoring. Lehman College has a similar program, and they will do the language piece. If you're up in Westchester, Westchester Jewish Community Services has a learning center that does any kind of psycho-ed testing, including autism testing. And there are complications in terms of insurance, but because you're all at different sites and your insurance issues are different, I'm not gonna go through all that today. If you have questions about finding neuropsych testing and you have a private insurance, email me, or Katie or Vanessa, because it's something we deal with a lot in our cluster.
I have a question, a general question.
Yeah.
At what point would you recommend school advocacy services?
I would say just if they feel like anything's going wrong. So this case is going to kind of, you mean when you go to the Board of Ed and you ask?
No, like to, just to
educational advocates,
like
resources for advocates, someone that you would recommend the parent to contact.
Yeah,
I would say if they feel like their kids' needs aren't being met, so the kid's been evaluated and the services aren't working, or they're having problems with evaluation. Like whenever you're hitting a roadblock, I don't think it hurts to bring them in.
I think also it depends on our ability and our bandwidth to do that advocacy. So if you feel like you don't have the time or the knowledge to walk, like, we'll provide your beverage. If you don't, like, if you feel like it's too much for you to walk a family through all of the steps that they need to make to get a neuropsych testing done through the Board of Ed, refer them out. I tend to, if it's a little bit more complicated than something that I can solve within my short-term course of treatment, I tend to refer to advocacy because I think they need an extra level of hand-holding. Sometimes you can get people that will go to the meetings with them. Sometimes there are educational attorneys that will work with them, which is way more than what we're able to do.
I think the challenge is I have never had a good experience referring a family to them.
Right.
And by that I mean I'm on hold for a long time, they don't return messages, parents complain.
Me too.
So I feel really bad for this subgroup of our patients because I feel like they're just falling through the cracks. And I know it's a systems issue, but I also just want to acknowledge that I think that's many of our experiences.
And I think when children have certain times you call, right, and often you just get someone who takes the information or get a message. There is a woman I spoke to this summer, I can send her email, who can push it a little further. So I would say
make sure
they get connected, just saying call advocates. 8 out of 10 times might not work, but if you call with them or you do a follow-up call or you harass them a little bit, usually you can at least make that connection.
Has that been your experience?
Well, no. So I'll call with them, we'll leave a message, and sometimes we'll get to someone if we hold for a long enough time.
Right.
And I have that time, but then even I'm thinking two families who did get connected, it still sort of ended up going nowhere, and they didn't get the help that they needed.
Right. The truth is you got to be on top of them, which then puts in that extra legwork, right? So if you keep hovering over them and putting in calls, they're going to do it. But again, in this case, which I'll do super quick because we don't have much time, the mom didn't quite get what to be asking about. So then even that conversation with Advocates for Children wasn't working because she was so up in arms but didn't understand kind of why. So she wasn't quite explaining the problem the right way, and so she needed the extra help to explain it. So yes, you often have to be there also, which then gives you more work.
But I think if you have ever talked to someone that you think is helpful, like if we share that information with each other, and then we keep, that poor person, that's what it is, right? You find someone who's good, and then you keep bugging that same person, and that's the best thing to do.
You know, and I wonder if our new community... I wonder if this is something they can help us with, like the persistent follow-up, because I'll be honest, I don't have time, and then I feel really bad for my patients because I know they're probably going to fall through the cracks.
That's actually, and sorry, just one more thing, is as we were going through this, that was a discussion I wanted to raise, is within the BPIC model, how much time do we have, you know, what's your comfort level, and different people have different bandwidths for doing this kind of stuff, and I don't want people to necessarily think that they have to do X, Y, and Z, because it's not necessarily realistic within what we have to do, and managing some of those feelings, but at the same time, doing what we can do in the space that we have. So, I don't know, food for thought.
Yeah, no, if you don't
have
much time, should we skip the cases? I don't know.
You have 10 minutes. Can you do one?
I can quickly buzz through transition and giftedness and then go back to the cases?
Yes.
Okay, so.
Don't find out what happens.
Yeah, no, just don't
worry. You're going to have a lot of clicks here, I'm sorry.
Surprise! Can I ask a quick question?
Keep going.
Yeah.
That's all.
Is the bar, so for a kid who has an IEP and is no longer in the general ed setting, is the bar lower for passing a grade? Because a lot of parents have said that and that they're concerned that they're passing even when they shouldn't be.
This came up with this kid and this romance. With the IEP, they have what the bar is to pass, and sometimes it's lower, depending on what the services are. So like, this little one was being passed the third grade, still at a kindergarten reading level, because her IEP said all she had to meet was a low enough criteria. If you see that happening, that's when I would say to the parent, potentially, look deeper if there's something that's not being addressed. You know, sometimes it's not as clear, but a kid who can't read at a mid-kindergarten level is going into third grade, to me, it was kind of like a, this doesn't make any sense.
Yes.
Right.
And is that, I'm sorry,
right.
Is that on the IEP at all?
On the IEP, there's a section and then like long, ridiculous document that says like expectations or something like that. And it can say like expectations will get 50% of comprehension like this year. And you're like, great, so they're getting what they should have gotten. You know, they're at a level they should have been a while ago. So it's on there, and that's why they're going to keep being passed up. So if you feel like that's a real disservice, that's an eyebrow raiser for me, that something's not right.
Well, there was a Supreme Court case like within the past half a year or something. I don't remember what state it was, but basically the debate was like, is it that the child reaches like some sort of minimal level, you know, versus like giving them services to reach their full potential.
Right. And sometimes they're never going to totally get there, potentially. Like, if you have a really bad learning deficit, you might not hit the level we want you to hit. But I think it raises a flag that it's something not being done that's enough. You know, just kind of like, why is this kid not progressing at all? Or let's just make sure at least they're really getting everything. Because you say you're giving them all these services, but are you giving them all these services? So it's just a good point to kind of say, yes, there's some level where they might never hit a certain standard, but let's make sure that's not because you are not teaching them, rather than they really, capacity-wise, can't get there.
And this is also why it's really important for the parents to be educated and present at the IEP meeting, because it's at that IEP meeting where those standards are set, whether it's, you know, graduation, your promotion criteria is 20%, and if the parent says, no, I don't agree with that, then we can have that discussion. Also, along, just as a quick, just brief thing on that, if they are setting promotion criteria as 20%, but they're not doing alternative assessment, be prepared for a kid who's pulling their hair out or causing trouble for everyone else when the state tests come, because you're expecting them to, you're letting them be promoted with getting a 20, but then giving them this super high stakes, oh my gosh, everybody needs to do this test, expecting them to do well when you're expecting them the rest of the time to do 50, 20% of the work. So that being said, to shift over to developmental disabilities.
We'll talk more about that too when I go into high school.
So cause there were questions about like autism and things like that. So special education classifications for, you know, developmental disabilities. You have your autism, intellectual disability, possibly multiple disabilities. Where do these kids get served? Yes, it varies. So District 75 schools, specialized schools in a district school, in a like non-D75 school. We'll talk very briefly about ACEs, NEST, and Horizon programs. But they might also be served in a non-specialized program in a district school. And that can be because, you know, there's the mandate is that kids should be served in the least restrictive environment, and all of these other things are considered. more restrictive. So the idea is if we can give them X, Y, and Z supports, and keep them in a general education or ICT kind of setting, that's what we're supposed to be doing. You might also run across parents who, there's a lot of stigma around District 75, so they say, no, I don't want my kid in District 75 school, but they're floundering where they are because they're not getting, you know, the right supports are not available there. So the ACEs program, it's for kids with intellectual disability or multiple disabilities. They have to participate in alternate assessment. It gives opportunities to learn some academic work as well as kind of independent living skills. It's a special class that's in a community school. It says handout, but it will be on the iDrive, the ACEs program guide that gives more information about application criteria and all of that. Similar programs for kids on the spectrum. The NEST program is for higher functioning students with ASD. Their academic abilities should be about on grade level. Their primary needs need to be language, social skills development. They can't have any real behavior problems, and they're put into a reduced size ICT class with teachers who are trained to work with kids on the spectrum. At the school building where my clinic is, one of the schools has a NEST program. They do phenomenal work, and it can be really, really tough to get kids into it. Similar, the Horizon program is for kids who are below grade level, have a little bit more difficulties. They might have some behavioral difficulties, though not necessarily like severely aggressive. It's a special class, 8-to-1-to-1. They use ABA. There are kind of guidelines for application and eligibility on the iDrive. Outside of the school, OPWDD, I think that the take-home message for all of this is there's a lot of potentially helpful good stuff that can take a lot of effort and legwork and time to obtain. There are certain eligibility requirements. They need to be enrolled in Medicaid, but anybody can really kind of start the application process for this. Eligible diagnoses, intellectual disability, autism, cerebral palsy, you can read this. The front door is kind of the first step for where parents start accessing these services. So we submit an application for this, it gets screened, they get an appointment, they say, all right, come to the front door at this location. There's going to be an orientation. Parents are given this. And then they might get a coordinator. There's necessary documents, include psychological testing, needs to have IQ, like full IQ, not a WASI, need to have adaptive behavior testing. That can be Vineland, adaptive behavior assessment system, as long as it's like a standardized one. Social, developmental, psychosocial history, and IEPs can be helpful, but aren't always needed.
This needs before. To get done right to get in.
Yes.
Yep. So they already have to go to like YAI or.
Yes.
Okay.
Or have had this done
yeah,
by
like
the school.
Early intervention
or.
Or
occasionally they'll do it. Rare. I've asked before. Violin's actually not that hard to get, so they should be able to do it.
Right.
But. Once or twice, mm-hmm. I've had success with that.
And only
not.
Children with Medicaid can get through OPWDD?
They can get switched over to Medicaid, but you need, because all of this is funded through Medicaid, they need to, so they might have to give up their private insurance
and
get into.
There's like a Medicaid case manager.
It does open the door in terms, because a lot of the autism services, especially in the Bronx, are really only for kids with Medicaid and Medicaid managed care. So if you have a private insurance, sometimes I will recommend that parents apply for OPWDD. So they can get the Medicaid waiver and then get access to those programs. And even if kids are little, like even I was thinking, how would this apply to healthy steps? So if we have kids that are first getting diagnosed with autism, I think it's a good idea to let parents know and start the process now, because even when they're young, it might not seem like you need respite services, But when they're 14, they might want like a social skills program on the weekend, and you're already connected into that system. And also, Jay left, but I had a case at Astor where it was the day that I wasn't there, and there was a kid who called a pediatrician because it was a child that was autistic but was having a psychotic break. And so do they go to OMH? Do they go to OMRDD? And he ended up going to the emergency room with a lot of help from Jay and from Dr. Bardwash. But the take-home message is, for a kid like that, they should have OPWDD services in place
already
before that kind of stuff.
But because it is so difficult and so much gets put onto the parent to do, we've often found parents who they get lost.
They give up.
They give up. They, you know, or they need so much handholding to get it.
I did find out recently that there are a few, I have to look up the names and I can send it out. There are a few agencies that do what they call handholding for parents going through the process in the Bronx. So they'll basically just, like, for parents who need that support, walk them through the whole process. I know AHRC does it in the Bronx, and there's one other one. So I have those numbers I can share.
So, and there's also another thing that'll be on the iGrad that might have some of that information. There's this Bronx Developmental Disabilities Family Support Guide as of 2016. It's a PDF that has more information than you need, but we'll have a whole bunch of, there are certain sections that give contacts for, you know, broken down into different age groups, different types of services, and so on. So it's a very long document, that's why we're not printing it.
We just have a couple more minutes, unless the group really wants to take this to the very end, and other presenters are willing to just be as brief as possible. Would you all prefer that?
I need like a minute.
Okay.
Sure. Do you have slides on gifted and talented?
Yes.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yes.
How young can a kid be to get hooked up with them? Four or five?
I don't think. No.
I think they just get the diagnosis.
Yeah. Really? I think it can be younger. So I think in healthy steps, it's something that we could have on the brain.
Yes. And they need that autism diagnosis. So I can do it all as soon as you can. Because once they get into the school system, I guess they're lost. And then you have to get them re-diagnosed. And you're like, but I diagnosed them when they were five. Why are we re-diagnosing them at they're 11? And they're like, because we need documentation. We need testing.
There is no, there are bullet points with certain diagnoses. Probably not. Eligible at birth.
There we go.
So I'm going to go through transitions if you have special ed services from preschool through age 21 and giftedness in 5 minutes. If I can do it, hopefully. But basically there's a bunch of like sticking points as kids with disabilities grow that are really important for us to pay attention to, because these are the places where kids fall through the cracks. And the first one is when kids are turning 3 and aging out of early intervention. So at about 6 months, 2.5, they should be starting evaluations to determine if they're going to get preschool services. And the EI coordinator is supposed to help with this process, but it can be tricky to link up the EI coordinator with the CPSE coordinator, and I find that sometimes that's something that I'm doing is looking up, like, well, for your district, who's the CPSE coordinator, and helping the parents make that connection. There is, depending on your birthday, you can technically start receiving CPSE services before you turn 3, because you're going from a federal calendar to a school calendar. I'm not going to go through the details because I can't quite wrap my mind around it, but case by case. Sometimes, depending on what services you're getting in CPSE, if you're getting more services or better or preschool, you might want to leave EI early and go to CPSE. But sometimes, if CPSE decided they're not giving as much service, you might want to stay in EI. And that's a decision that parents have a choice in, and we can provide some guidance. Something that I don't know why I didn't realize this, but if your child is going to a universal preschool site that's through the Board of Ed, you can get CPSE services there, assuming it's in a public school. And so what you would do is if a child that was not getting EI before is apply for CPSE, for CPSE eval at the same time they're doing their UPK applications. There's detailed guides on all of these things that we're going to put up on the iDrive. Something super new and exciting is that this year DeBasio announced 3K for all. So, yeah. Right now it's started in two districts. One of them happens to be our lovely South Bronx District 7, and planning to expand citywide. I'm assuming that same thing holds. If your child is eligible to go to 3K and they need CPSE services, you do those both applications. One question I have is, depending on where those sites are located, can they get those services in the school, or will it be more like it comes outside of school and they have to use those vouchers? The other thing I wanted you guys to know is that the Board of Ed has an early child direction center in each borough, and Laura and Kate are going to be working with the Bronx ECDC to build a partnership there so that we can, ideally the plan is that we could use them to help families that are younger than 5 connect up with CPSE services. Once kids are going to kindergarten, this is called the Turning 5 transition, and they're going over to CSE. Per the DOE, someone from CPSE will refer the child to CSE, and then the parent will get contacted. But I'm not sure that I've ever heard of that happening independently. So I think that's something that we need to check on. And again, if the child never got CPSE services going to kindergarten, you think that they might need something, or the parents do, they would apply to kindergarten and the CSE at the same time. So middle school, high school, and beyond, unless you're in District 75, which is a special education district, you have to do the same middle school and high school application process as any other kid in the Bronx or any other kid in New York City, which is a kind of a big pain in the neck. And your IEP goes with you. One thing that's interesting to know is, so starting like sophomore year, kids are supposed to be invited to the IEP meetings, which I never realized, but I think, you know, we can start encouraging kids that they can, you know, they can go and they can know what's going on and they can have a voice in the whole process. Starting in sixth grade, kids that have IEPs also participate in vocational assessments. And this is a long-range plan that goes from sixth grade until they transition out that looks at what goals they have for high school and college and what supports they're going to need in order to meet those goals. So there's tons of specialized high school programs depending on what your strengths are, what your interests are, what your abilities are. And so starting in sixth grade, you know, they interview students, parents, and they do these assessments to gather all that information and start that conversation going. It looks at academics, related services, community and social experiences for kids on the spectrum and kids that have, that need support there. And then, what kind of employment setting do you imagine this child is going to be in once they're done with school? What kind of living situation are they going to be? Are they going to be able to live independently? There are outside agencies that help with that process. BESSET is now called that really long.
Access.
Yeah, whatever it's called. High school alternatives. If you have someone who's not able to function in a regular high school setting, they can go to the Bronx Referral Center, which is kind of like a clearinghouse for different programs, and they can help figure out the best way for them to graduate and or get a high school equivalency. They also do help with referrals for counseling, for concrete services, for kind of other needs that might be affecting kids' ability to to be in school. There's also this lovely website, Path to Graduation. Path to Graduation is a program that's housed in the Bronx Referral Center. And so it's like you can either go yourself or you can go on the website. This is some kind of combination. But this is something we could do in a session, right? Go online and look at what options are. So some of the options for kids, this is for kids that need a small group setting. They have at least a year of high school. They're either in danger of dropping out or have already dropped out. And they do academics, college prep, work experience. This is a night class for people that have daytime responsibilities. So it's a little bit older. Next slide. So when I was at Early Head Start, we participated with a life program in Long Island City High School, which was a daycare center located in the high school so that kids could drop off their babies and go to school. And the one that I worked with we were doing Early Head Start curriculum and supports in that program. So parents had that benefit too, and families loved it. And I think they got a lot of benefit from it. There are also...
I know at least Clinton High School.
We have six health centers that are in buildings with life centers. We have a lot of connections to the life program, so if anyone has any questions, they can email me. If you put in touch with the folks on the program.
And that would be great for all our Healthy Steps team moms, team dads.
Yes.
If you have someone who's really into the tech field but is having trouble getting through all those high school region classes, there's the School of Cooperative Tech, there's the School of Rikers, and there are programs for kids recovering from substance abuse who are kind of transitioning from that program into a supportive school. Now, in terms of graduation options, you have your advanced Regents diploma, your regular Regents diploma, and they're still calling it the local diploma. It's just based on how many Regents you passed and how many credits you get. With an IEP, you still have to take those exams, but if you don't pass, depending on how many credits and depending on what your career goals are, you have these other ways to graduate. It still means that kids have to go through the stress of taking the exams and especially if they're not going to do well. There is this career development and occupational studies commencement credential that sometimes goes along with one of those diplomas or can be by itself. And this is basically saying that they've completed the requirements to graduate and that they have mastered certain career development and technical skills. This skills and achievement credential is not as strong as this, but is another option available for kids that cannot meet the requirements for the CDOS. When you graduate, all that transition planning from sixth grade on, you have an exit summary, which outlines present performance, accommodations and supports, goals and recommendations. So as you're going off to college, what are your goals and what recommendations would be helpful to meet those goals, which is something that you can give to your college counseling office. And then connections to organizations that would help you, whether it's OPWD, OMH, VESA, things like that. I think the most important thing for kids who are thinking about going to college is to make sure that they have that triennial review within 3 years and that they do a full... If they're looking to get accommodations for the SATs or in college, they need an IQ and they need confirmation of the diagnosis. The College Board is not going to take a diagnosis from 6 years ago. And that some schools require adult norm testing. So the WISC has an adult version. The Woodcock-Johnson goes up until age 89, so you're good there, but there's some reading. The Nelson-Denny is one that's popular for reading. The other thing is, I want everybody to know that college is an option. It's just about finding the right type of environment for them. And one of the things I strongly recommend to parents is look for schools that have supports, have learning centers, have peer tutoring, have, you know, a good counseling program. There's a lot of resources online, and there are certainly some programs in the Bronx that will help kids with the college. I know I just sent a kid to Bronx Works to their college prep program, so I think those are available. So I'm going to super speedy talk about gifted and talented services. These are only available from kindergarten through third grade. And in a couple of, the next slide will show you the schools in the Bronx that have gifted and talented programs. You can see there's two in each district. Well, 8, 9, 10, 11. If you are not working, if you have a kid that's not in one of those districts, can you go back to the other slide? There are citywide programs where kids from any district can apply. There's a huge handbook that I will put onto the iDrive from the DOE website. Basically, they have to take this test. There's a nonverbal ability test, which is there's no speaking. It's really visual, spatial problem solving, connecting dots and puzzles and all kinds of stuff that I'm not very good at. And then there's the verbal reasoning, which is answering questions and vocabulary. They have to get greater than a 97th percentile, so and that's a nationally normed test.
And all of those are in English and have to be administered in English?
No, there are alternative languages available. And all the documents on the board, by the way, are available in like 20 different languages. But the tests are available in multiple languages.
For the gifted and talented?
Yeah.
And then the nonverbal test is nonverbal, yeah. So there's no language component. Yeah.
were there any questions about gifted and talented? Yeah.
So the application process, like, would you go like?
I took that slide out in the interest of time. But basically, what happens is that in the beginning of the school year, the parents go onto the Board of Ed website, and you can sign. You can get outline of the process, and you can sign up for these email blasts that will tell them you submit an application for the test around like November or so, then you take the test, then you get your results, and then once you get your results, you go and you look at the schools, and then you decide if you're going to accept it or not.
I think the actual test happens in January, and then they hear back around April. So they can't access a GNT curriculum in their school. They're reporting to a different building.
You would have to go to, yeah, if you qualify, you go to the building where that program lives.
I think a lot of parents don't know that. A lot of parents think they can stay at the school and get to the talented curriculum.
They don't have, you know what, it used to be that all schools had some kind of gifted, I'm thinking of like when I was in school, like all schools had some kind of gifted and talented aspect to it. But I feel like at least 10 years ago, they really cut down on those services. And now they still have these certain programs, but it's not.
Or you have to get in.
You have to get in.
From kindergarten.
You can apply later on. Like you can apply in first grade or second grade, but.
At some point that gets cut off.
Yeah. And I imagine there's not many slots because most people are applying in kindergarten.
We have to wrap it up.
So the only thing I wanted to say is that we are going to put all this information for you guys into, we were struggling a little bit with exactly where to put it, but we're going to figure that out, and we will email you all the information and a link to where it's located on the iDrive. I came up with some handouts for parents, like if they are concerned about reading or attention, my kid won't do their homework, from my old testing reports and this stuff. So
there'd also been a request for information about school health center, like school-based health programs.
Want to just turn the line up?
The information about the Montefiore programs for dissemination, but there's also, there will be on the iDrive just a list. It's an Excel document with non-Montefiore school-based health centers.
Well, see, the problem is we have 25 health centers, but we actually work with 90 schools. Because every campus now is broken down into multiple schools. Some of our high schools have, campuses have 7 schools. So to have a complete directory, we do not have a complete directory with every single school. It's a little onerous for us, but we can provide the location.
And yeah, there's a document for the non-Montefiore program, so that'll be on the iDrive.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.